talk about following Jesus today. Worked out perfectly in God's synchronicity of time to have Luke's profession of faith on a Sunday when we're talking about following Jesus, which he has committed his life to do. So we're going to look at Mark chapter 1, verses 14 to 20, part 2 of our series in the Gospel of Mark. We'll journey through all 16 chapters together in the next year. So it'll be quite a journey through the shortest, and many say one of the most powerful of the Gospels of our Lord. Mark chapter 1 at verse 14. After John was put in prison, referring to John the Baptist, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he'd gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Jesus said, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away." Thanks be to God. It's been said that a man's first words and his last words are the most important words that he ever says. We all know that when a president takes office in our country, the media pays particular attention to their first speech because they know some things are going to be said in that first speech that kind of set the course for the days and the years to come. Those are defining words in a very defining moment for our nation. Likewise, when a man or a woman dies and is about to take their last breath, it's not uncommon to see family members gathering right there to hear what they're going to say because they know that those words that are spoken in that powerful moment may capture the essence of what this man or woman wanted their life to stand for, what they want to say to their family members as they part from one another. We know the first and the last words of Jesus Christ from Holy Scripture, not when he was a toddler and just learning to speak, of course, but his last words for us are in the Great Commission. We talk about that a lot around here. "Go and make disciples of all nations," and then it ends with that marvelous promise, "and surely I am with you always, even to the very end of the age." Folks, never forget that Jesus is with you. He's with you. You have those days, I have those days, we all do, when you're tempted to think that God has forgotten you. It just kind of feels like, he's forsaken me, I don't know where he is right now, but I don't feel like he's with me. Jesus promised that won't happen, can't happen. He will never leave us. Those words can give us great hope, give us great comfort in those difficult days when that's how we're feeling. The first recorded words in Scripture of Jesus' life, found in Luke 2:49, are those words that he spoke to his parents. You may remember this story. Mary and Joseph had gone to Jerusalem, and they were on their way back home, and they realized after a couple of days, 3 days, that Jesus isn't in their company of their family, so they head back, and they find him in the temple. Remember, and he's speaking at the age of 12, this is, to the scribes and the teachers of the law. And Jesus says to Mary, "Why were you searching for me? Didn't you know that I had to be in my Father's house?" First red letter words in Scripture. But today, in this passage that we read, we have before us the first words of Jesus in his public ministry. So this is coming right out of the baptism in the Jordan by John the Baptist. And verse 15 of the text captures for us in nugget form all that Jesus is about. "The time has come," he says. "The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." Because those words are so important, let me summarize them just briefly. First, Jesus says the time has come. He means the time for him to begin the work of salvation, the mission that God the Father laid upon him to come and bring redemption, to bring deliverance, to rescue us from the power of sin and death. He also means the time that all of the prophets foretold, all the way back to Genesis 3, verse 15, about the appearing of the Blessed One, the Messiah, the Anointed One. Secondly, Jesus says, the kingdom of God is near. He is saying something enormous in that, folks, that we can't even wrap our finite minds around all that it means. Millions of books have probably been written. Endless sermons have been preached on the kingdom of God because it is the primary theme, the primary emphasis of Jesus' life and teaching. He's the King of kings. He's the King of the universe. He came to this earth to bring God's eternal kingdom to us. What is the kingdom, you might ask? Well, it is God's complete and perfect rule over every person, over every nation, over every power, over everything in creation. God's kingdom is his mighty power in action, demonstrated for us so many times through the miracles that Jesus performed in his public ministry, and especially through his resurrection from the dead. Thirdly, then Jesus says, repent and believe the good news. He's telling us to turn away from our sins and put our trust in him. Notice that it's not one or the other. It has to be both. The Greek word translated in English repent is the word metanoia. And with that prefix meta, used in words like metamorphosis, you know that it has something to do with change, right? Something to do with transformation. And that's exactly right. It's a changing of your mind. It's a changing of the direction of your life. But friends, it is not enough to simply clean up your act and try to live like a good person. Because Scripture is clear that God doesn't save people who try to prove their own goodness through morality or good deeds or whatever. God saves those who believe his good news. He saves those who believe in Jesus Christ, which means to wholeheartedly accept the person and the claims of Jesus Christ as the Son of God, as right and true and for you. Jesus is calling people to take him at his word because his words are the words of God, eternal words that have life and freedom and truth. He's inviting us to believe that he is the only one who can forgive our sins, take away our guilt, make us right with God, bring us to his heaven. He's the only one who has the right and the authority to do that. So that is why Luke follows Jesus. That's why I follow Jesus. That's why everyone should follow Jesus, because of those three things. I want to turn our attention now to the rest of this passage. I've gotten to the point, maybe you have too, where it sometimes disturbs me a little bit to hear some of the names and the things that are being said about believers in Jesus. Words like evangelical, are you an evangelical? Even at times the word Christian, because these words in our culture, because of Christian bashing, they have started to carry social, political, and other kinds of baggage. Stuff is getting attached to those, and people label you as soon as they hear, oh, you're a Christian? How do you respond if somebody asks you, so what religion are you? I think a good way to respond, and actually I think this is a very biblical way to respond, is to say, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. So there you go, Luke. If in the future people say, well, what happened at church on Sunday? You can say, I am now a follower of Jesus Christ. We can say that. The gospel lesson today clearly speaks of this call to be followers of Jesus. But I found in my study that quite a bit of the original meaning of the words here is lost in our English translations. I discovered some amazing things here, and I'd like to share them with you. I don't want to, you know, bore you with trite things about the Greek language, but there's power in the original meanings here. So I know some of you study a Greek interlinear text. You appreciate word studies that kind of delve deeply into that. So we're going to do some of that. There are actually four different Greek words that talk about following in these seven verses that we read. Four different words. Let's take a look at them. The first one is doute, used as the first word in verse 17, come. Simply means come here, or come to me. Matthew uses it in Matthew 11, where he quotes Jesus as saying, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I'll give you rest. It's a word of welcome and invitation. It's the same thing that we mean when we're speaking to our pet dog, come. It means simply get up from where you're at and move to me. Think for a moment about what the disciples had to leave behind, literally, in order to come to Jesus. The text says they left their boats, they left their nets, they left their income, they left their family, they left their community. They left a lot behind. This is the same word, by the way, that Jesus uses in his conversation with the rich young ruler. Remember that? Who very well understood exactly what Jesus was calling him to leave all of his possessions, all of his wealth, and come, follow me, but he couldn't bring himself to do it. Nowadays, it seems that many people in our culture, a very consumer-driven, materialistic culture, a very wealthy culture by comparison to the third world, simply think of adding Jesus to their bag. Yeah, I think I'll just put my faith in Jesus, make my life a little bit better, might be a little bit happier, whatever. Add Jesus to my bag. But Jesus says, no, if you want to follow me, you need to leave some things behind. Might be friends, might be family, might be wealth. Be prepared to leave some things behind. The second word that Jesus uses here is opizo. It's used as the next two words in verse 17, follow me. The word actually means come behind me. So come to me, Jesus says, first of all, and now he says, when you get to me, stay behind me. Don't run out of ahead of me and expect me to follow you. No, 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 that's not how this is going to work. And don't expect me to walk alongside you as though you are somehow equal to me. I am the teacher. That doesn't work either. If I am the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, if I am the master, the teacher, the rabbi, stay behind me. Has the same sense of being under in the Greek, behind, under. Like when we talk about a business or a store being under new management, we're under Jesus' authority. We're under Jesus' control because he's ahead of us and because he's over us, King of Kings. There was a saying about disciples among the Jews. They would attach themselves to various rabbis, different schools of learning in their time, and it says that these disciples, whether they were, you know, Jesus' disciples or any other, would walk in the dust of the rabbi. Walk in the dust of the rabbi, which means trailing behind, and as he's walking, he's kicking up the dust, and they're walking in that dust, taking in every word and learning. So the disciples walked behind Jesus as a sign of their submission to him. And because Jesus said, no student is greater than his teacher, no servant is greater than his master. That's how it is for us. Third word translated follow here is the word akalutheo. I love that word. Used in verse 18, they left their nets and they followed him. It actually means to attach yourself to bond yourself to. Think about duct tape. to attach yourself to. Used in Greek society as kind of a political and a social term to connote having a personal connection, maybe an affiliation to a leader or to a group of some kind. So someone might say, I am akalutheoed to the Republican Party or the Democratic Party, or I'm akalutheoed, I'm attached to so-and-so for governor, so-and-so for president, or what have you. Jesus called his disciples to attach themselves to him in a way that meant putting away all other allegiances. He was saying, come and join my school of teaching. Come and bond yourself to my way of life, my way of thinking, my values. It speaks of a singleness in our loyalties. Because what did Jesus say? No one can follow or serve two masters. You can't be attached here and be attached there at the same time. You can't choose to follow Christ and follow the world at the same time. James 4:4 says, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Powerful words. So you have to choose. And Jesus calls you to choose him. Stay attached to him. Because he's the way. The only way. He's the truth. The only truth. He's the life. The only life. Fourth word, last word translated follow in our text, is the Greek word apergamai. The end of verse 20 says they left their father Zebedee and they followed him, meaning Christ. The meaning of this word is different. It's more like going forth or launching out, much like Abraham launched out from Ur of the Chaldees or from Haran when God called him to leave his family behind and go to the land that he would show him. It's setting out in a new direction, and it's literally putting your body into motion to go in that direction. It has some physical movement involved with it. And it involves, obviously, remembering and doing all of the other three kinds of following that we just talked about. So you stay behind Jesus, you let him lead your life, you stay attached to Jesus, you don't allow other things to compete with him, you keep on leaving the things of the world so that you can follow Jesus and not your own selfish interests, and then you go forward physically, mentally, emotionally, in every way with Jesus, following him. Isn't it amazing how much gets packed into a passage, and yet we can miss it because we're not all students of Greek. And that's one of the joys and blessings for those of us in Christian ministry who get to teach and preach the Word of God, is to unpack these mysteries and truths that are right there in the text, but how would we know unless someone tells us? There's a couple more things in this passage that I want to call our attention to this morning as we close. In verse 17, the NIV translates Jesus saying, come follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Now the original Greek would be better translated this way, come to me and walk behind me and I will make you to become fishers of men. Jesus is saying, I will cause you to become something that you are not. I will change you. I will make you a new, different person. You know, being a volunteer at church, whether it's teaching in children's worship or Sunday school or with the GEMS and the cadets or helping out in the sound booth, helping out in the nursery, whatever it is a way of following Jesus that can make you not only a different follower of Jesus, but I would say also a better one. Here's my point. If you don't feel like you are growing and maturing in your faith, maybe it's because you are not serving enough. Now, think about that a minute. Maybe it's because you're not serving. If you volunteer to teach a class, who will learn the most in that class? You will. If you volunteer to serve on a ministry committee, guess who will probably benefit and be blessed the most? You will. Of all the Christians that I have known over the course of my pastoral ministry, the ones that are the happiest, who are the deepest, who are the most dynamic, and who feel the most fulfilled are those who are actively engaged in the ministry of the body of Christ. No kidding. Actively engaged. I'm not saying that you should volunteer to do things for selfish reasons. Obviously, that wouldn't be honoring to God. But this, friends, is how God designed it. What did Jesus say? It's more blessed to give than to receive. St. Paul taught us that a person reaps what they sow. What does a sower do? A sower casts seed, flings seed far and wide. They put it out there where it can take root. It can yield a harvest of righteousness, a harvest for the Lord. What that says to me is that we have to be careful that we don't allow ourselves to slide apathetically into a place where we are takers in the church rather than givers in the church. Okay? We're not meant to sit here and just receive, be blessed, go home, live it up, come next Sunday, sit down, receive. That is not how Jesus lived. That is not how the apostolic church lived. We're called to serve. Jesus said, the greatest one among you is the one who serves. I came not to be served, but to serve and to give my life. And Paul says in Philippians 2:5, let your attitude be the same as that of Christ Jesus. The next thing I want to call to our attention today, the last thing, is that we are fishing for people. In order to understand this teaching of Jesus, I think we really need to do a little bit of research because there's a lot to it. And when we do, we find something that's pretty amazing. In Matthew 13, Jesus tells the parable of the net. And the first thing he says there in verse 47 is the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and it caught all kinds of fish. Now, Jesus isn't trying to teach them about fish. He's trying to teach them about people and about people coming into the kingdom. Now, any well-studied Jewish person would immediately recognize in Matthew's gospel, which was written to a Jewish audience, by the way, a prophecy of Ezekiel. In Ezekiel 47, the prophet is describing his vision of a river that flows from under the temple and into the Jordan Valley, and it makes its way down to the Dead Sea, where it makes everything fresh and alive. It's a dead sea until this water reaches it and it becomes fresh and alive. So Ezekiel writes, in verse 10 of chapter 47, fishermen will stand along the shore from En-Gedi to En-Eglaim. There will be places for spreading nets, and the fish will be of many kinds, like the fish of the Great Sea. The Great Sea? That's a reference to the Mediterranean, of course. Let me give you a little bit of trivia. Studies have been done by marine biologists just within the last few decades that have established the scientific fact that there are 153 different kinds of fish in the Mediterranean Sea. Not 152, not 154, 153 different kinds of fish in the Mediterranean. Now, if you look back at the second book of Chronicles, you'll see in chapter 2, verse 17, that it says this, Solomon, King Solomon, took a census of all the aliens who were in Israel after the census his father David had taken, and there were found to be 153,000. Not 152,000, not 154,000, 153. Who are these people? They're the outcasts. They're the strangers. They're the homeless. They're the orphans. They're the oppressed. Now, one more fascinating thing. In the post-resurrection account of John chapter 21, Jesus comes to the disciples along the Sea of Galilee. You remember this account. The disciples are out fishing. They've actually been out fishing all night, and they have caught nothing, right? So they were working hard for hours and hours, zero results. All of a sudden, they see a man walking on the shore. It's Jesus. He hollers out to them, "Put your nets down on the other side of the boat," and reluctantly, because they tried both sides of the boat all night long and have caught nothing, they do it anyway. And so when they do that, in obedience to Jesus, they bring in a huge catch. Now listen to verses 10 and 11 of John 21. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore, and it was full of large fish. Guess how many? 153. I checked to see if that was a prime number, and it's not a prime number, but it's an odd number. 153. John tells us exactly how many fish they caught. Do you suppose that that is any kind of a coincidence, that it just happens to be 153? I sure don't. Jesus is saying, "I want you to catch a lot of fish. People. Many kinds of people. So get out there following me and catch them. Go and catch the aliens. Go and catch the orphans. Go and catch foster kids. Go and catch learning center kids and families. Go and catch oppressed people, people in the bondage of addictions. Go and catch all these different kinds of people who are down in life and feeling the weight of life. And they need the life of Christ. Go out into deep waters. Go out into dangerous waters. Go out into waters that you've been in many times before. Go into waters that you've been in for 149 years. Go and catch them. Bring them in. People of God, that's God's calling on us. That's God's mandate for us as his people. And the question that we should ask ourselves is, well, are we doing this? Are we doing this as a church? Are we doing this personally? The answer, I believe, at least for us as a church, is yes. At least to some extent, we are. All of our missions giving, all of our mission trips, like the trip that Joanne explained to you earlier, all of our mission efforts are for the purpose of fulfilling that mandate and that commission. Every day that you volunteer to serve in the ministry of this church, or maybe it's a Jehovah Jireh, or International Aid, or Love in the Name of Christ, or some other Christian mission, you are throwing the net. You're putting the net out there. Every Wednesday night, every Sunday morning when you assist with children's ministries, youth ministries, every summer when you lend a hand for vacation Bible school or go on a trip, you are walking in the dust of the rabbi. Walking in the dust of Jesus and doing the thing that he called us to do. So yes, I believe that we are doing this, but quite honestly, after even 149 years of doing this together as a congregation, we're just scratching the surface. The need is so great, and it keeps changing, right? As people move into the Grove and into Jamestown Township, it keeps changing all the time. More people need to know Christ. Friends, there is so much that needs to be done. One of the problems that we have is that we tend to limit our field, our understanding of our place of service as what goes on here within these four walls. But that's not the point. Jesus didn't operate that way. The early church didn't operate that way. They didn't have buildings. They didn't have a whole bunch of programs. They had Jesus. And they got out there in the world and they shared Jesus. And you and I are here today because of that. I came across a quote this week that I thought was pretty interesting, pretty convicting. Take a look at this. "Too many Christians are no longer fishers of men. They're just keepers of the aquarium." Has the church in America become a place where we like to just kind of school together in our nice, clean, comfortable aquarium and stay in safe waters and not get out there where the Lord is calling us to go? Think about that this week. I started this message talking about the first and the last words that a person speaks, and mentioned that the Great Commission is really the last words that Jesus said before he ascended from the Mount of Olives. Do you remember the very first words of the Great Commission? The first word, I should say. Go. Go. That's what we're called to do. Every single day, no matter where God puts us, at school, at work, in the neighborhood, volunteering somewhere, go. And make a difference where you go. Be a disciple, a follower of Jesus. That's what Luke gave himself to today, or when he met with the elders. That's what we all gave ourselves to when we professed Christ. That's the church. Aren't you glad that you're a part of it? Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, what a calling. What a trust you've placed upon our lives. And Lord, it's not like you're sending us out there among wolves, even though we sense that that's true in some ways, but greater is the one who is in us than the one who is in the world. But Lord, you're sending us out just as you sent out the 70 in the Gospels into the villages of Judea and the countryside around Galilee, and you empowered them. You sent them out with the Holy Spirit, and they came back rejoicing, declaring, "Even the demons submit to us in your name." Lord, great things were done because of the power of your name, that you were with us the whole time. Lord, let us remember that. Let us understand that. Let us believe that at a level that we've never believed, so that we know that we are your ambassadors. We are your missionaries, right at work, right at school, right in our neighborhood. We are ministers of reconciliation between people and you. We're the bridge. We're the only Jesus that some people are ever going to meet. We're the only word of God that some people may ever hear. Lord, use us. Take us as salt, as light, to change this world for your kingdom. Lord, fill your banquet table, fill the room with followers of Jesus, because we are found faithful and obedient to this call. Thank you for trusting us with it. And thank you that we don't go alone, that you are with us always, even to the end of the world. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me in singing, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus."
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
The world behind me,
world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
Though none go
with me, still will all follow. Though none go with me, still will I follow. Though none go with me, so I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back.
I have decided, let's sing this one more time.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided
turning back.
No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.
So go. Go and follow. Follow hard. Run hard. After Jesus, remember the gaze of the Father fixed on you, delighting in you, saying, I love you, I'm well pleased. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit going with you every day. Go in peace. Love and serve the Lord.